all welcome to Wallasey Town Hall. Thanks for attending today. Since we've got attendance today, I think it'd be mindful that a lot of people won't know each other, so if we can introduce ourselves, if that's okay. Just go on and say, well, I know there's names on it, but it's you, so it's something. Councillor Pat Hackett, the leader of the council.
Graham Watkinson, I'm director of the Health.
Mark Thomas, Prevention Manager from Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service.
And Paul Boyce, Director for Children's Services.
Paul Cannon, Chair of Wirral.
Paul Cannon, Chair of Partnerships and Strategic Development at Wirral Community Health and Care.
Simon Banks, Chief Officer of Wirral Health and Care Commissioner.
I'm Matthew Swalmer, Director of Strategy at Wirral University Teaching Hospitals.
Dolly Adam, Medical Director, Cheshire and Wirral Partnership. Councillor Pat Cleary, I'm leader of the Green Party Group on the Council.
I'm Brian Simpson, I'm from Magenta Living and Chair of the Wirral Strategic Housing Partnership.
I'm Nikki Allen, I'm Head of Medical Finance and Mental Health in Greenwood.
Hi, I'm Hugh Stone, I'm Head of Community Action Wirral.
I'm Jackie Canning from Health Watch Wirral, and I'm covering for Karen Fryer, Chief Officer of Health Watch Wirral.
I'm Mike Shakeshaft, I'm from Health Watch Wirral as well.
I'm Keith Stevens, I'm Managing Director of Wirral Emotions.
I'm Sue Talbot, I'm Assistant Director of Education and Strategic Lead for SEND.
Amanda Creswell from Public Health England, I'm the Environmental Public Health Scientist in the North West.
I'm Rachel Musgrave, I'm a Public Health Consultant with Wirral Council.
And I'm Catherine Philby, Prestige of the Lib Dem Group on the Council.
I'm Chris Jones, Cabinet Member for Arts, Care and Health in Wirral.
And Pat
Phillips
from Committee Services.
I'm Julie
Rose, I'm
the Director for Health and
Wellbeing
for the Wirral Council.
Yeah, great. Thank you everybody, thank you very much. Okay, we'll get on to the agenda in front of us. The next one is apologies for absence. I've already seen a number, including Karen Howard, CEO of Wirral NHS Community Trust, with David Hammond is attending. Superintendent Gary O'Rourke, Karen Pryor, Shakespeare will attend if you're here, obviously. I believe the Health Watch will not be presented, will it?
Sorry?
Health Watch will not be presented.
Yeah,
it'll be left over until the next meeting. Yeah. And the last but not least, Councillor Ian Lewis. Okay? So, the next one is minutes of the last meeting. Is it agreed that I sign now? Four on the agenda is Wirral Evolution's annual report and a presentation by Gene Stevens of Wirral Evolution. Gene.
Thank you. Firstly, thank you for inviting me to give this presentation. As you know, I'm Gene Stevens, I'm the Managing Director of Wirral Evolution. I've been in the post for 9 months now, started in February, but prior to that, I was the Chief Exec of a company called Merseyside Sports Partnership that works across the city region nationally, promoting the benefits and the difference it made through physical activity and sport and health and wellbeing on people's lives. I'm going to try and keep the presentation down to about 10 minutes, so I will skip through the first part of it because I'm sure I'm probably talking to the converted in this room, and I want to share with you really some of the case studies and some of the difference made by the people that we support at Wirral Evolutions. Examples of the differences that's made, but I'm aware of the incorporated in 2015, were wholly owned by the local authority, but were set up as a limited company by shares, and our shareholder is obviously the Wirral Council and the leader of the council. Our work is around outcomes. It's about ensuring that the people that we support in our service, the 400 people with learning and physical disabilities, have positive outcomes, that their lives are enriched through physical activity and mental well-being, that their skills are developed through developing their confidence, their resilience, their motivation, their social skills to enable them to take part in what we consider ordinary activities. We also, one of our outcomes is around community integration, around supporting pathways into employment, volunteers, education and training within that supportive environment. Excuse me, can I get my laptop? Because I can't see that over there. Is that all right? While it's loading, since coming into post over the last 9 months, we've focused on our strategic intent, looking at the future direction of where Wirral Evolutions needs to be, ensuring that we've got some real guiding principles around putting the people that we support at the heart of everything that we do, looking at choice, making sure there's choices available for the people in our service, looking at how the social value and the benefits of those people in our service and what that means and how we can ensure that we are supporting them in the right way that meets their needs, whether it's in the service or outside of the service. It's also around their health and well-being. We've inherited an institutionalised service whereby a lot of people that have been placed within Wirral Evolutions have been there for quite some time, 20 years, the majority of our people service, and they are getting absolutely superb care and support within the environment. But in terms of positive outcomes and skills and development, we want to ensure that we've got a wraparound service to enable them to take part in activities outside of Wirral Evolutions in the community, whether that's volunteering, education and training, as I've said there before, or supportive pathways. In terms of our statistics, 2018-19, 409 people in our service took part in over 200 activities throughout that calendar year. And that doesn't seem much in the community, but this is around making sure that the supportive pathways are in place within the community. Some of our case studies will show, apologies, Sue, can I hear this? Can someone, can I swap places with someone and then do this presentation again? Thank you.
Is it Julie? Is it on the screen now?
No, I asked Pat that and she said no. There's not another screen mic, is there?
Yeah.
Is there?
There is, yeah. So it's smaller.
It's small there as well, isn't it?
Well, can you see the reading glasses though?
Might be easy to see on there, but on the wall. Oh. Ah. done in post, we've rejigged the outcomes in words and what we're trying to achieve. And what we want to ensure that we put the people that we support at the heart. We focus on physical and mental well-being to enrich the people's lives that we support. Well-being in terms of increasing their enjoyment, self-esteem, their resilience, and making sure that their happiness is important as part of their friendship and isolation, to reduce that isolation. That their skills are not only developed in line with what perhaps parent carers and supporters want, it's what they want as individuals, encouraging their confidence, their choice, exercising control. We're a big push on community integration, and I mentioned earlier around volunteering, employment, supported education and training, and social connectivity. And we achieve this through a number of ways. We do it through creative arts and crafts, physical well-being, hospitality and catering, the great outdoors, beauty, technology, vocational qualifications, education and learning, and community volunteering and employment life skills. And we also offer advisory and advocacy support. The way we work, as I've said to you before, we're wholly owned by the council. We're a limited company by shares. We have a strategic board with areas of expertise across business, finance, audit and risk, and adult social care. But since also being in post, I've strengthened the governance arrangements and how we work. For some reason, the organisation stopped talking to people over a period of time. We've re-engaged with parent carers. We've provided structures in place to allow the people that we support to have a voice. We have a Speak Up, Be Heard forum, which they advocate their own views and help shape the service as we move forward. We've reintroduced the volunteer forum, and we've re-engaged with charities and significant partners. In terms of our strategic intent, our purpose is to enrich the lives and opportunities of people with learning and physical disabilities. That's our purpose. That wasn't really clear when I came into post. It might have been clear to all the people within Wirral, but it wasn't clear to me. And so we've re-looked at our strategic intent. Our vision is around enabling people that we support to have choice and exercise control over their own lives. And our mission is around moving those barriers, inspiring lives, and working together. But our values, as you can see, is around personalisation, integrity, quality, openness, accountability, and collaboration. And the outcomes that we're all striving to achieve is around those four that's highlighted up there. Lives enriched, well-being improved, individuals developed, and communities integrated. I talked a little bit earlier in my introduction around guiding principles. We fundamentally believe and subscribe to our guiding principles around personalisation, collaboration, and supporting pathways to enable people that we support at the heart of everything we do, that choice enhances skills experience, that their quality service delivery is the highest standard, that our social value, that we support the people that quantifies the benefit to them and their life experiences, and the economic value about operating in an efficient and effective manner that enables our growth. So some headline statistics and difference made. This is the important bit really for me that I wanted to share with you this evening. Okay.
Could you just open a little bit?
Yes.
All right,
I'm
just not as fast as...
Oh, no, it's all right, I'm trying to catch up. Okay, in 2018-19, 407 people that we support took part in 544,000 hours of enrichment activities. And they're the activities that I mentioned earlier on the other slide. Of that, over 200,000 were in the community. We want to increase that, and we've made massive steps this year to improve that. 84% of our parent carers said that they were satisfied and very satisfied with the overall service provided in 18-19. We currently have 70 volunteers that are the sort of lifeline of some of our locations. We wouldn't be able to operate without these volunteers. And just 70 provided nearly just under 500 hours of volunteering, which equates to a value of over £100,000. It's something that we've now put in place in terms of a volunteer strategy and a framework to increase that, but also to reward, recognise and value volunteers. 95% of our workforce have took part in education, training and development, over 52 workshops, that's in 1890. That's significantly increased in this year as well, because some of that was before my time. We've got over 1.4 million people clicking on our website. That's again, that's significantly increased this year. And then some softer highlights around improved engagement, which I shared with you before, around working very closely with Together All Are Able. There were a local advocacy service that's run by people with learning disabilities, for people with learning disabilities. And they really have helped us understand and bring together the Speak Up Be Heard, which is now attending over 50 people from our service that have got a strong voice and are helping us co-design and co-implement services that benefit the people in the service. We've improved quality standards. We've had an improvement team in the last 6 months that's gone through all the services, reviewed all the paperwork, so much paperwork, and streamlined in an efficient and effective way. And we've also had investment into a couple of our locations, Pensby, and a couple of day experiences. I mentioned before we strengthened our governance arrangements by recruiting some more non-executive directors, and we've improved our performance monitoring by introducing a comprehensive balance scorecard, which will demonstrate all the values that we've said before. So some of the case studies, I've only got three, so I'm nearly done, guys. These are three people within our service, and we've got so many examples of the difference made. When people look at statistics, and I know that statistics are important, but it's the difference made and the journey that the people in our service have travelled within the context of their supported pathway. So we had an individual that was referred in September 18 with severe medical conditions, very socially isolated, withdrawn, suffering from low self-esteem. And she requested that she wanted to improve her confidence to independently travel, to see and experience other things, which most of us take for granted. So on the left-hand side, as you're looking at the screen, they're just some of the steps that we put in place to support this individual. But I just want to focus you to the right-hand side, really, about the difference made. This individual now attends more activities and is more socially integrated and feels less isolated, and her confidence has grown so much that she travels independently to the day centre now, which she didn't do before. Her confidence has also improved, that she articulates her own views now, and she's one of the advocates now in the Speak Up Be Heard forum, and is actually helping educate and train some of our workforce on people's voice. She also expresses herself through singing, and she sets herself goals. But she's not, the bit that's really important is she started to volunteer within an art class, and she's helping other people develop art and to help them express themselves. So she's become a leader as well within the context. So it started with she had no confidence. Now she's got confidence and she can conquer the world. So that's one example. I've got two more. This individual, an early referral, July 2018. A family was struggling to find a provision for her outside of school when she finished. She was scared to go outside. She was distressed. She was hitting herself. She was making herself feel sick, and she was confused. She was refusing to leave her parents' car. So again, I won't bore you with the details on the left-hand side about the support that was put in place. But the difference I want to stress is that her distress behaviours and anxieties, both at home and in the settings, have significantly reduced about the interventions that the teams and the support staff have put in place with her. She's integrated fully into the setting now. She has lunch with her peers. Prior to this, she wouldn't. She'd sit on her own in a corner and wouldn't speak to anybody. And she's now grown that much her confidence that she's now independently travelling to the local library and getting new experiences and gaining more knowledge. I know that doesn't sound much, but it's huge. It's massive. Okay. Next one, please. Thank you. Okay. This young man lives with his parents. He's got learning disabilities, autism, and he attends one of our settings, Best Bites, which is a catering service, as well as he attends Liverpool College 2 days a week. He found himself that he found that he couldn't focus, and when he got into panic attacks, he would be waving his arms and walking at pace, and he wouldn't be able to communicate effectively. So again, a number of interventions that was put in place along the left-hand side, but again, due to time, I want to focus on the difference that's actually made to his life and his journey. He can now follow simple verbal instructions, staying focused and using his own initiative to complete tasks, which is massive. His social skills and confidence has improved significantly. He's able to communicate independently to the customers. These are members of public that walk in off the street and ask for a butty, ask for a coffee, and if they don't like it, so he's able to deal with that situation. He's also achieved Student of the Month at his college, and he's passed his food assessment qualification, and he independently travels again on public transport, and he walks to our setting now. He's also coping, working alongside people for long periods of time. He couldn't do that before. And then last but not least, he's also now, well, he has achieved this, his Open Award Diploma, which is such a massive achievement. Okay, that's me done. Thank you very much, and apologies for the presentation. It did work on mine. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll do the same if you want.
Thanks, Jane. Thank you very much. Any questions? Graham?
Jane, thanks very much for that presentation. It was really good. And I think that just in terms of background, we're the evolution that came out of what used to be Council Direct Delivered Service. And the cost of that service was reduced significantly in the transfer. But what I've seen with the Relievolutions is a great increase in terms of the quality of the service. Very strong morale amongst the staff, and people that are very satisfied with this type of service. The most important thing, though, is the kind of shifts that you've made in terms of those relationships with parent carers, with the volunteers, and the shifts into enabling people to get into employment and enhance their lives, basically. Taking that, actually a large number of the people that you work with are older and they've been in the service for a long time. But I suppose it'd be useful to understand the sorts of, the plans for the future, I think, in terms of how you're going to develop that and work with us as commissioners in the service to enable that kind of growth in the
Thanks, Rick. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, 9 months in, we've done an awful lot of fixing some of the past and then trying to make sure that we're just constantly looking forward. But plans for the future is around those key principles that I've highlighted up there around the five drivers of our guiding principles around people at the heart, choice, quality, social value and economic benefits. And we're in the process of producing our business strategy. We've got our strategic direction, we know where we're going, we know we want to be more outcomes focused and making a difference into all those that I've said before. And our business strategy will provide 9 drivers of change, which will look at specialist facilities, but a lot of our future planning is around day experiences with positive outcomes. So a whole model in terms of, we know we need some locations, but more of less of them. A whole model with more day experiences that will have pathways in place to an end game. I really appreciate that, you know, there's varying degrees of learning disabilities within our service. But I even question myself coming into the company of why certain people have been that long in our service. And it's not that I just want to get rid of them. I appreciate that they may come back in later life with a different qualification or a health need. But the pathways have been put in place from the beginning. We've got an ageing population. Out of the 400, 60% of 55 and over. We've got 7%, which are only 18 to 25 year olds. So it's, and I'm sure 20 years ago they were in that age bracket. So we have what we have, but the pathways and the future plans are around when people come into our service. It's about sitting down straight away of what the pathway, support pathway looks like and what that means for them. We're also looking at one of the drivers around, in the context of our locations, around people banding. And I know it's not a nice subject because I've just talked quite lengthily about putting people at the heart of everything that we do. Over time, people have needed more support as they've got older, as they've been in service, as more complex needs have achieved. And the structures are not right or fit for purpose within the organisation to meet that as well. So they will be looking at those options as well. And we'll also be looking at one of the drives around corporate social responsibility, working with businesses, working with other partners to help us to achieve the common goals that we're trying to help with the people we support. So does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Chris Jones.
Thank you, Pat. I was lucky enough to come spend some time with Jean and with some people who actually use the service, as well as a member of staff. And this is going back very soon, really, Jean, after you took over.
Yeah.
But I think the Jean's attitude was so positive, and I think it's the cultural change that is now really starting to show, you know, about moving people into volunteering and employment and all the rest of it. And Jean did take over a very institutionalised service, and I think she's done fantastic things in the first 9 months. But it was the joy of the service users, and for me in particular, the member of staff actually brought tears to my eye because she said what a difference the service now was with the changes in the paperwork, the change in attitude from the top. And I was just so pleased to hear that. And that was absolutely brilliant. But good luck to you, Jean, and keep going.
Thanks. Councillor Brooklyn.
Jean mentioned consolidation. And because many of the users of the service are of a particular age, we're very familiar with surroundings, probably very familiar with travel arrangements, or perhaps live locally to where they're receiving services, even if the services become hubs and they then go out to other experiences, I'm just trying to work through how a change would be achieved.
times, looking at what the service needs to provide, and we will not do any changes until we do formal consultation. And that was the real priority of when I first came in, is to re-engage with parent carers, the people we support. Believe it or not, there was no evidence in the organisation that anybody asked the people that we support what they wanted and needed. So we've introduced some of the other practices that used to happen. But we will go through a consultation process, but it's early days yet. For me, when I make a consolidation, in some settings we're battling around and the facilities that we're in are not fit for purpose for the people that we support. Some of them are, and some of them are amazing, but there's a couple that's not.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to hear the presentation, to be honest. I think it's fantastic. No, I think the direction is the right direction. And the good thing about all this is that you are looking at this from the well-being lens rather than from a health lens, because sometimes other places they can get it wrong from that point of view. My question is in terms of what further plans have you got in terms of further integrating the people you work with in the community? And secondly, what help do you need from us?
I'll get me less stats. In terms of community integration, I believe, if we get that right, and it's in the context of the individual, and that was the main reason we worked together collaboratively to produce the strategic framework around those outcomes. So that was done in partnership with parent carers, charities, the people we support, of the shareholder and the staff, to make sure that they're the most important outcomes that people want to achieve. I also had significant evidence from when I was in my previous role of the benefits of well-being and how it can change people's lives and how you wrap that around. So I've took the principles of being honest from my previous world and brought it across. So more integration, absolutely, but meaningful integration. So it's not just about everybody's going to go to Costa for a coffee. Coffee's nice, but the important bit is around the confidence, the skills, having the ability to be able to use the right money, to get the change, to ask for the coffee, make a choice of what coffee the individual wants. So it's about meaningful outcomes and how we measure them in terms of social good and an economic benefit. And in terms of what I need, I've come from a strong partnership basis and a collaborative world in my previous world, and I find that could be improved here in Wirral, and especially if we're trying to have supported pathways into employment, education and to volunteering, because whilst an individual in my service can get the same qualification as a member of staff, in the outdoors, we've got two individuals that've just got a level 2 qualification in shrimming and using chainsaw, things like that. If you place them in a work environment, it's all the other aspects that goes around the individual that it's not straightforward. So support really. I would want more collaboration around those supportive pathways, because it's the same person. It's the same person that was in school. It's the same person that came out of school, is in my service, and that will go and access other services within the community. So a more coordinated and collaborative approach to supportive pathways.
Thank you. Dr. Paul Campbell.
Thanks. I really appreciate your presentation, and I was able to.
I wish you were not the guys.
Just follow on what Ozzy said there. I think I'm a GP as well as my current government of the CCG. It's how we can, you talked about pathways and collaboration, but it's really about integration, isn't it?
It's about
ensuring that it's sent out to all of the GP practices if you'd like, and that would really start to, you will get an influx of referrals. But it's what age would you want patient, service users to be, to start using your service, and how can we in primary and community care about that?
In terms of the people that we support, it's age 18 and above. Our sort of age profile is that we've got quite an older population within our service. I think there's so much potential for younger adults, and because the younger adults want different things, they want technology, they want to use apprenticeships, sport and physical activity. They don't. Some of the younger adults in our service don't see their learning disability as a barrier, and nor should they. And we're piloting, and I'd love to come back and show the outcomes of the pilot in a couple of months. We're piloting with 10 more sort of higher capable people in our service with learning disabilities around a supported pathway. But it starts with what's the choice? What is it that they want to do? Then we've helped with education and training with our parents and carers, because we've got such a culture that parent carers sometimes don't want their loved ones, their children, whatever age they are, to be more independent. And it's a challenge for us in our service, and that might be because some of our cohort has been there for 20 years and a big percentage of it. So I do that, put that with a caveat with that. And as a result of those supported pathways, those 10 individuals, 6 of them have achieved their Open Award qualification. One person's gone into an apprenticeship, one's gone into volunteering, 2 have moved into independent living and have interviewed for their own manager on their own. It's just, it opens the doors to everything. But in answer to your question, we're probably not ready for referrals, if we're being honest, because I don't believe we've got the right offers in place, especially for the younger adults at the moment.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jean, for the presentation. Can members note the report? Can I just echo as well, just quickly, what's been said as well? I visited the place. The same reaction as well.
Very, very quickly, I think I'm going to use that. It was probably linking on from Paula's question, Jean. I totally see you again. Paula and I, Jean and I worked together years ago. What are your options for creating? And we know that there's an awful lot more than just 400 adults with learning disabilities on the world. So have you got options to work across everybody with learning disabilities in their adulthood lives? And what is your option for grades? You answered the question, I think, just at the end there by saying you're not necessarily open for referrals. How could potentially the Health and Wellbeing Board help you to grow?
Yeah, absolutely.
As an organisation?
Absolutely, and that's what we want to diversify in terms of our growth. We currently, as people will know, we have a permission from the authority to deliver services for people with learning disabilities. But what I want to do is grow sort of the younger adults, so the 18 to 30, in terms of supported pathways, and I would be looking for additional commissions or and resources to support that. The challenge we've got is we're trying to manage some piloting of that within budgets, and budgets, as everybody knows, is quite challenging at the moment, isn't it? So in terms of that side of it, we will be looking at growth, but also looking at growth into the community, into the business world, around social corporate responsibility, getting benefits back, and doing it that way. I don't intend on, someone else asked me this question, do you have an ambition to have 1,000 people in your service? It's not necessarily about the number, it's about the positive outcomes and about pathways and about the journey. And if we can give more people, if more people leave us for a positive experience into a supportive pathway of volunteering, education or supported employment, that's brilliant, absolutely brilliant. It's that we need support, funding and extra resources for.
5, special education needs and disabilities, and self-evaluation presented by Sue Talbot, Assistant Director of Education here at the Council. Sue is presenting the findings of self-evaluation of special education needs and disabilities, SEND services. This has been completed by a number of departments, both of the preparation for a CQC Oxford review. Sue, over to you. Thanks.
He's hoping the technology works.
Yeah.
Oh, oh,
self-evaluation document, very welcome to see a copy of it if you want. It's a working document, I think we're up to 54 pages with embedded documents in it. And it's been contributed to by partners across the local area. So what I aim to do is just give you a brief overview of this to kind of set the scene of where we're at. So, there have been significant changes in leadership and staffing since the implementation of the 2014 SEND reforms. We've had three interim heads of SEND in the children's services, and we've only just got a permanent head of SEND, special education and needs and disability, who took up post in September. And that is a really positive thing to have a permanent leader in that area. There's also been changes in staffing due to posts being paid from fixed term grants rather than budget. And this was when the SEND reforms came in and they need to change statements into education health care plan, the conversions. So each local authority will need a grant